Greetings, fellow scholars of the Lifestream. I'm Kudakuma from the Cosmo Canyon Observatory, and in this episode of the Game Analysis video series, we're going to cover something different to the Final Fantasy VII Remake for the first time, Final Fantasy XVI. Our lovely patrons voted to interject some Final Fantasy XVI content before continuing the mysteries of Final Fantasy VII Remake. Stay until the end to learn more about our plans for upcoming videos. When Final Fantasy XVI was finally revealed a while ago, its trailer was met with mixed reactions at first. While it was hard to get a feel of the bigger picture just from the trailer, their recently published website contains more information about some of the characters and especially the world of Valisthea. So much, in fact, that we can't wait to take you on a journey through the beginnings of this long-awaited new mainline entry. And with that, let's travel to Valisthea and explore its warring realms and mysterious crystals.
The land of Valisthea is studded with mother crystals, glittering mountains of crystal that tower over the realms around them, blessing them with ether. For generations, people have flocked to these beacons to take advantage of their blessing, using the ether to conjure magics that let them live lives of comfort and plenty. Countless wars have been fought over the mother crystals all around the land, leading to the rise of nations such as the Grand Duchy of Rosaria, the Holy Empire of Sambrec, the Kingdom of Valode, the Dalmekian Republic, and the Iron Kingdom, each with their own culture and ideology. Ongoing skirmishes have forced an uneasy peace between these nations, but with the emergence of the ruinous blight, that fragile peace is starting to deteriorate.
Besides the description about their existence and effect, there's not much known about their nature and origin. Where do they come from? Are the icons creatures which were sealed away in those huge crystals and now need dominance as a tether to be able to manifest within the world? Was there a time before the mother crystals with icons roaming the land? Was the world born from those crystals? Let's start simple. The visuals. Each crystal is gigantic and bears its own color and shape. The Drake's Breath looks like either a fiery talon or a dragon's fire breath emitting from the volcano. The Drake's Head has the shape of a very uneven icy wall. The Drake's Spine either depicts clouds on a pillar or a huge geyser. The Drake's Tail has the biggest similarity to a classic Final Fantasy crystal. And the Drake's Fang is a literal mountain, at least on the world map. In the case of the dragon's breath and tail, they look like gigantic shards which fell from the skies. The shape of the land around them even supports this theory. Is it possible that all mother crystals originate from space or another planet? If they did, aether would therefore be an alien energy and might have completely reformed the land, flora, fauna, and societies around them. This could explain the people's dependency on the crystals, which bind humanity by spreading their aether like a forced symbiosis. It's also possible that their descent happened before humans were civilized or even existed. The terrain around them is also worth exploring. The Drake's Breath might have created the volcano in the first place, and the Drake's Head could be responsible for the rift near the sea, having caused a huge body of water to flow inland, creating the peninsula it's residing on. The Drake's Spine seems to have created that huge crater in the northernmost part of the eastern continent, causing the seawater to flow in through the newly created inlets to the north, which ended up forming this circular array of islands. The Drake's Tail, being very sharp and long, might have just driven up the planet's crust to elevate a natural bridge between the two continents, with it creating the vortex to the south. What about the Drake's Fang? Maybe it just fell into the mountains there or even created them upon impact. In any case, the different realms seem to be heavily tied to their mother crystals, so let's have a look at those introduced on the official Final Fantasy XVI website.
Long ago, a group of small independent provinces in western Valisthea found strength and unity and formed the Grand Duchy of Rosaria. It draws its ether from Drake's Breath, a mother crystal situated on a volcanic island off the coast. The dominant of the Phoenix, Icon of Fire, is enthroned as Archduke when they come of age.
On the world map, we see one bigger castle and four smaller towns within the borders, which is most likely depicting the capitals of those five provinces. Rosaria also contains a rather large river delta shaped like a claw. It's close enough to the orange mother crystal Drake's Breath, which sticks out of a volcanic island westbound off of the coast and already lies within the Iron Kingdom. Those scenes from Rosaria in the trailer are most likely showing the main province, whose capital is depicted as a castle with two towers on the world map. Within the trailer, during the standoff between Phoenix and Ifrit, a portion of the castle and its towers are visible. Though, it looks more like a square castle with a low tower on each corner, unlike the icon depicted on the world map. Either Clive and Joshua live in the town to the north, or the big towers on the southern castle are actually a representation of those we briefly get a glimpse of during the battle between Phoenix and Ifrit, even though we see more than two, and they don't look like they belong to the castle. Those towers don't even look like they belong to any normal city, more like pillars from an ancient ruin or something. Could it be that the scenes with Phoenix arriving and Ifrit unleashing his Inferno attack happen near the end of the game, whereas the other scenes take place in Rosaria? The rest of the footage during the attack on Rosaria definitely all happens in the same location, the castle's courtyard. In the last shot of the battle with Clive against the Imperial Dragoon, we can see the same background that's also visible behind the Flaming Dominant. Same big doorway, same red Rosarian banners, same barrel cart, same wooden scaffold behind and spare struts in front. The only difference is the bigger destruction above. We see the dead silver chocobo in the lower right just before the beheading, and later again on the left side when Joshua starts the summoning. We'll go further into Phoenix and Dominance in another video, so let's focus on the succession. The description says that whoever becomes the dominant of the Phoenix will also become the current Archduke's successor when they reach adulthood. As the description does not explicitly talk about genetic successors, we assume that a dominant born outside of the Archduke's family may also rise to the throne. It's therefore possible that either Clive or Joshua is not the biological son of the Archduke, as their different hair color suggests. But more on that in the video about the characters. Let's have a look at Rosaria's banner. It's mostly red and depicts a white phoenix, which can be found on banners all over the city, near the training yard, in the castle's courtyard, as well as during the indoor battle later in the trailer. It also contains 8 sword-like crosses, which can be found on Joshua's red clothing. Fun fact, Final Fantasy XVI's Rosaria might be an appropriation of Rosaria from Final Fantasy XII, which we never got to visit and don't know much about, despite its importance in the story. From the little that is known, the Grand Duchy of Rosaria doesn't seem to have inherited much, if anything, from the Rosarian Empire, besides being located in the west as well.
Sanbrec is the largest theocratic force in Valisthea. The Empire's holy capital, Oriflam, is built around Drake's Head, the mother crystal that blesses the surrounding provinces with abundant ether. The people happily take advantage of this, living in comfort and security under the watchful gaze of the Holy Emperor, whom they worship as the living incarnation of the one true deity.
In the Holy Empire of Sanbrec, their dominant acts as the Empire's champion and is sent to war to decimate their foes. Their icon is unfortunately blacked out, but we will present a solid speculation in another video. Oriflam, Sanbrec's capital city, and the Drake's Head, their mother crystal, are situated on the peninsula to the north. The city reminds of Swallow's Nest in Crimea atop the Aurora Cliff. Additionally, it almost perfectly mimics the Mother Crystal's shape, tall at the cliffside with a declining height land inward. In this artwork of the bombastic city Oriflam, we can even spot shadows of Clive and a seemingly friendly wyvern in the lower left. It also looks like different classes are separated into their own walled-in areas, most likely spanning from common folk to nobles and royals. Interestingly, the city layout somewhat resembles King's Landing from the Game of Thrones TV show. Although Oriflam itself stands atop a cliff high over the lower city, while King's Landing shows barely any elevation differences. Furthermore, the Drake's Head Mother Crystal in the background heavily reminds of the Icy Wall, which protects the southern realms from the dangerous north. Someone in the Creative Business Unit 3 seems to be a hardcore Game of Thrones fan. As an aside, The Creative Business Unit 3's logo reminds of a phoenix, the main summon besides Ifrit in Final Fantasy XVI. Whether this is the official Division logo or just adapted to this game has yet to be seen, as we haven't found an official logo outside of the trailer yet. Also, do you remember when this artwork was released alongside the news of Square Enix working on an unannounced HD core title? Many people already had a feeling that it was about Final Fantasy XVI back then. In November last year, this game was already in its full-scale, large-scale development phase, so there's a good chance of it releasing in early 2022. One can dream, okay? Anyway, the Empire of Sanbrec is rather large and encompasses around one-third of the Western continent. Sanbrec's banner possesses the main colors blue and white, while the iconography on it is presented in intricate gold stitching, befitting a holy empire. The holy figure within the halo-like circle might depict the holy emperor or empress, as they are considered a god by the people. Two mirrored dragons fill the part below the figure, hind leg, front leg, tail, and wing, which is weirdly placed too high. It also bears six symbols reminiscent of Celtic crosses.
Valode claims the entirety of Ash, the eastern half of Valisthea, as its dominion. The kingdom's control of the continent has oft been tested by the orcs and other beastmen who make their home there, but the current ruler of the realm has succeeded in quelling their rebellions. Using the power of the kingdom's mother crystal, Drake Spine, this new king has built up a mighty army, with which he now seeks to test the borders of his neighbors.
Malone's mother crystal, the Drake Spine, lies in the middle of some sort of laguna within the circular archipelago, as does its capital city. Either built on another island, surrounded by water, or directly built on it, keeping it afloat with aether. The crystal appears to be shaped like cloud supported by a tall pillar. On the other hand, it does resemble a geyser, complete with sea spray around it. However, this might just be an artistic choice, like the white shadow on the ocean's surface cast by the Drake's tail, or the red reflection on the water by the Drake's breath. There's not much to say about its banner besides the horse and the pole arm on the inner shield, but more on that when we talk about the icons. In general, this banner might be a symbol for the ruler, a dominant, protecting his realm, hence the outer shield. Orcs and other beastmen roam the continent who apparently keep trying to regain dominance. The border which splits the continent in half might signify the divide between the civilized and the uncivilized regions of the realm. Malone's testing of borders seemed to have happened in the past, as we see a smaller patch of land on the western shores, which might belong to Sanbrec, while that smaller region within Sanbrec might belong to Valode, both being the results of the constant back and forth between the two nations. It's also quite possible that Valode begins testing borders yet again at some point during the game.
The Dalmechian Republic is made up of five states, from which the members of its ruling parliament are drawn. Its mother crystal, Drake's Fang, is half hidden in the heart of the mountain range. The Republic's control over it, and its ether, securing the obedience of the large part of southern Valisthea. The dominant of Titan, Icon of Earth, is installed as a special advisor to Parliament and has significant say in its decision-making.
The world map only shows two cities and one town within Dalmec's borders. If each resides within a separate state, where are the other two? It's possible that each state has its own borders drawn on the world map, of which there are four. Unless the small island in the south depicts the fifth state. Their mother crystal resides within the biggest area and is depicted as a yellow mountain. Strangely, the mountain range the official description talks about is nowhere to be seen on the world map. There is more to say about Dalmec, but we'll cover that in another segment, so let's have a look at their banner, which is a very interesting one. Besides the intricacies, it clearly depicts the five states which the Republic is made of. It bears five bigger symbols on the lower part of the whole imagery, with the middle one showing additional adornments, possibly depicting the state where the Parliament is located. In the middle, we see a bust of a heavily armored warrior, possibly depicting Titan or its dominant. Around it, we see icons of five elements: air, water, fire, earth, and void, or aether. Those are incidentally the five elements in Japanese philosophy called the Godai. This whole image stands for the unity of five different states around the Drake's Fang under one banner. Its main colors are brown, earthy gold, and red, fitting for an area of mountain and desert. The scene in the meeting room where they're talking about their alliance might represent a smaller portion of the ruling Dalmekian parliament. Outside of the window, we see only rocks, which looks nothing like the crystalline dominion where the Council of Representatives resides. Furthermore, the window is made of iron poles instead of windows, and thus fit much better to the Dalmekian biome, as the crystalline dominion certainly has glass windows, looks brighter, and would not show rocks outside of the Council's chamber.
A small group of islands off the coast of Storm, the western half of Valisthea's Twin Realms. Here, the Crystalline Orthodox, an extreme faith that worships crystals, reigns supreme. The Iron Kingdom controls Drake's Breath, the mother crystal that sits at the heart of one of their islands, long a source of contention with neighbouring Rosaria. Isolated and aloof from the mainland nations, the Iron Blood speak their own language. Orthodox doctrine judges dominance to be unholy abominations, and any unlucky enough to be born on the islands are executed.
The Iron Kingdom is the least developed realm so far. Extreme crystal worshipping, orthodox doctrine, a separate language, disconnected from the other nations, and even hunting down and killing any dominant born within their natural borders. Their banner encapsulates their nature perfectly. Pure black background, intricate golden borders and corners to emphasize their unholy doctrine, which stands in stark contrast to a jagged representation of their mother crystal, Dragon's Breath, which even looks like an actual fire breath originating from below. Its crossed axes might stand for their brutal warfare. Those red anchors in the lower portion indicate a naval force and presence. Being situated on multiple islands with multiple ship icons surrounding them solidifies this sentiment. As an aside, the Iron Kingdom's description indicates that the Battle of the Twin Realms mentioned in the English version of the trailer indeed talks about the western and eastern continents of Valisthea. Lastly, the same description calls Rosaria's western border the Coast of Storm. Storm is indeed brewing over there with the coming invasion and Ifrit's appearance.
The Crystalline Dominion sits at the heart of Valisthea, built around the tallest of all the mother crystals, Drake's Tail. Many bloody battles were fought for control of this small plot of land due to its strategic importance, till the Warring Realms finally agreed to an armistice. As part of the peace treaty, the islands around Drake's Tail became an autonomous dominion led by a council of representatives from the surrounding nations, each realm enjoying equal claim to the Mother Crystal's blessing.
Since it's not a nation in the traditional sense and without a distinct ruling body, it does not house a dominant like four of the other nations do. According to this artwork, it's also built atop the possibly most beautiful and intriguing landscape we've seen thus far in Final Fantasy XVI. It reminds a bit of Venice in terms of architecture and the countless canals. But most importantly, those huge spikes of either stone or even crystal are a sight to behold, especially the central one around which the castle has been built. This central spire reminds heavily of Yoshitaka Amano's art style. The artist who is responsible for most artworks in Final Fantasy games up till 6, and created each and every Final Fantasy logo going forward. The city itself is situated atop the only feasible connection between the two continents without longer travel by ship, making this area a very strategic location indeed. Those representatives from surrounding nations are the Empire of Sanbrek to the north, the Kingdom of Walode to the east, the Dalmekian Republic to the south, and the Grand Duchy of Rosaria to the west, as indicated by their four banner symbols surrounding the central symbol of the Crystalline Dominion. The rest of its banner mostly represent the main elements around the Crystalline Dominion, its gigantic mother crystal towering over the city, and the waters surrounding it. The crystal's form closely matches the real one, as we can see in the portrait version of the key art, especially the jagged surface towards the top. The spikes at the bottom seem to be underground. The four small crystals at the bottom could represent the mother crystals of the other four nations forming the council. It's possible that another conflict will wash over this mother crystal and its location once again during the course of the game. That scene from the presumed Dalmekian parliament might be a precursor to it. We already covered the individual banners, but it's important to mention that each realm has its own small symbol on their respective banner. Rosaria contains 8 small sword-like crosses. Sanbrek shows 6 symbols similar to a Celtic cross. Willode has both top corners decorated with an adorned X-like shape and a dragon skull above. Dalmek boasts a whopping 12 diamond shapes, each with a smaller one dangling from them. The Crystalline Dominion presents 4 smaller crystals, obviously. The Iron Kingdom is the only one standing out, with its 2 large, rough, and fiery anchors at the bottom, compared to the clean and symmetrical symbols of the others, which underlines their isolated and aloof nature. The Northern Territories represent a yet undisclosed nation, which is likely hidden beneath the fog of war covering the northern third of the Western continent. It's where Jill Warwick, Clive and Joshua's confidant, originates from. Her transfer to the Grand Duchy of Rosaria ensured peace between both warring nations. It's a nation that swore loyalty to the Grand Duchy of Rosaria, which was possibly their only move to avoid total annihilation, and a good segue into the next segment. This yet mostly unknown nation to the north of Rosaria is dubbed the Fallen Northern Territories in Jill Warwick's bio on the website. Our conclusion is that both nations were at war for some unknown reason, which the Northern Territories lost and both nations agreed to a peace treaty for which Jill was the price. This in turn suggests that Jill must be very valuable to Rosaria. Either she's the Northern Territories ruler's daughter and princess, and thus valuable to their kingdom, or she is another dominant? It's possible that this was exactly the reason why Rosaria and the Northern Territories got caught up in this conflict in the first place. Unless it was as simple as an attempt to expand territory, or even seize control over the northern yet unrevealed Mother Crystal. Why? The answer ties into the next conflict. According to the Iron Kingdom's description, both it and Rosaria draw their aether from the Drake's Breath, which is located on one of the Iron Kingdom's islands and thus lies within their territory. A conflict is therefore bound to happen someday. Though it's unclear whether one already happened in the past, the tensions are certainly there, as this situation is long a source of contention with neighboring Rosaria, told from the perspective of the Iron Kingdom. It's possible that the Iron Kingdom is also involved in the invasion of Rosaria, possibly to eliminate the Phoenix, as it probably is directly connected to their mother crystal they worship so much. But this is pure speculation at this point, so we'll have to wait and see how the story unfolds. This conflict is only called the Battle of the Twin Realms in English. The Japanese version calls this the Continental War. As established in the Iron Kingdom's description, this war involved both continents of Valestea, which seems strange as continental war suggests a war within a single continent. Otherwise, it would be labeled the Intercontinental War. Though continental could also refer to the war having happened on land only and not the sea. Since the description of the Crystalline Dominion does not specify the amount of involved nations, we can't say for sure how many nations were involved. Looking at the world map, 2 nations directly border on the Crystalline Dominion's autonomous zone, Dalmek and Willude, though Sanbrek is still very close. This in turn suggests that the Battle of the Twin Realms, or the Continental War, was fought between at least those 3 nations. However, the Crystalline Dominion's banner shows Rosaria alongside those other 3 nations, which suggests that all 4 nations were involved in this war, which led to the armistice and the Council of Representatives. But why is Rosaria included even though it's located far off to the west? This narrow strip of land between Dalmek and Sanbrek might have belonged to Rosaria in the past. On the other hand, Rosaria's description does not suggest it being bigger than what we already covered. So, what's the alternative? Rosaria might have been allied with either Sanbrec or Dalmec during that time, or otherwise being involved in the war, thus earning them a spot in the Council of Representatives. In the Japanese version, the other important part of the Mysterious Lady's line reveals that Dalmec defended itself against them in the last Continental War, them being the Crusaders, as she puts it in the English version. Now, who are those Crusaders? The term Crusaders fits to both the Iron Kingdom and the Holy Empire of Sanbrec, as both can be compared to the Catholic Church during the Crusades. The Iron Kingdom seems a bit more extreme with their crystalline Orthodox belief, but the expressions Holy Capital and Holy Emperor, the latter being compared to a god, make Sanbrec just as feasible a candidate. But who is who? Let's first elaborate on the battle over the crystalline dominion. Many bloody battles were fought over the small but strategic plot of land around the Drake's Tail, as its description on the website reveals. As previously described, the Dalmecian Republic and the Kingdom of Velode are the only nations bordering on the Crystalline Dominion's autonomous zone. It's possible that this narrow strip of land, dividing Dalmec and Sanbrec, might have belonged to the latter in the past, and one of those previously mentioned bloody battles ended with Dalmec taking it over, adding their fifth state of the Republic. It's possible that this led both realms to form the alliance they're talking about in this trailer, possibly to help each other keeping Velode at bay as they keep testing their borders, which would strengthen the armistice. With Rosaria being part of that council as well, according to the Crystalline Dominion's banner, it's possible that the last Continental War before the armistice around the Autonomous Zone involved all three nations from the Western Continent fighting against the approaching Velode. But this raises the question about the Iron Kingdom's involvement, as they are described as being separated from any political madness on the mainland. Are they really the Crusaders the Lady talks about? We assumed that this Lady is a representative from Sanbrec, especially with her noble behavior and superior act in the conversation compared to the angry man, who we assume to be part of the Dalmecian Parliament. Are we on point, or did we miss the ballpark completely? In the Battle of the Twin Realms, aka the Last Continental War, Dalmec drove them back, as in the Crusaders, suggesting the battle we see in the trailer is being fought between the same parties plus the Dalmec's allies. The Dalmecian Republic is represented by those desert warriors, clad in several shades of dark cloth, covering their head but exposing their arms, holding scimitars, and carrying a small water skin on their side, which further suggests they are used to living in the water-deprived desert. We can see one of them standing in the back corner within the meeting room, which is more evidence for them representing Dalmec, in addition to their outfit fitting right into Dalmec's desert theme. The knights sent by the Empire of Sanbrec carry white cloth around their waist, which show blue adornments, the exact same as the Imperial Dragoon attacking Rosaria. In general, those knights are much better armored in terms of area covered and material, in this case, iron or steel. Interestingly, they also wield the same scimitars. Do the Dalmecs and Sanbrecs share their weapons and mounts in this battle? Would definitely make sense from a logistical standpoint. Their opponent, the warriors from the Iron Kingdom, are clad in hide, leather, and rivets, especially around their head protection. They look like savages with axes, similar to the weapon displayed on their banner. Some of them even bear intricate tattoos on their arms, probably designating their respective tribe. This analysis suggests that the Crusaders are indeed the Iron Kingdom's warriors, which also means that they did intervene for some reason towards the end of the last Continental War. Maybe because they thought Dalmec was too busy fighting a different battle and seized this opportunity to take back their former land or something. The Iron Kingdom does not seem to have access to chocobos, which might be the result of being isolated from the rest of Valisthea. We also see energy projectiles being shot against the Iron Kingdom side. Is it Bahamut's dominant? Shiva's dominant would make no sense, since Titan's dominant would be on the same side, as his dominant is a special advisor on the Dalmecian Parliament. We see two different sources of those light blue magic projectiles. Seems like they are emitted by mages who can use magic as well, not just dominants. If Joshua can bless Clive to provide him with the power of the flames, other dominants can do the same. It's also perfectly possible that many warriors and mages are able to wield magics by drawing aether from a mother crystal, as their description puts it. It's also not confirmed that the battle between the nations and the summons happened at the same time, so we can either assume they do, or are left with wild speculations. We chose the former for this analysis. Even though Shiva goes against Titan, the Iron Kingdom would never employ a dominant on their side, but rather kill them on sight due to their extreme orthodox belief. Shiva's dominant might act on her own to somehow help the Iron Kingdom by keeping Titan busy. This might be the reason for why the Marked Troop is tasked with assassinating Shiva's dominant, and only the dominant, to ensure the victory of Dalmec. But where does this attack take place, and why? It seems to be close to a city or outpost, as we can see a tower behind the rocks surrounding the battlefield. Titan also stands close to a city on the left, and the sea to the right. Which of those two bigger cities would it represent? While we don't see those pillars depicted on the Northern City's world map icon, it's still more likely to be this one, as its coastlines on the map match the one in the trailer more closely. Furthermore, the world map contains that small, sneaky ship icon very close to that coast, the only place to dock before being swallowed by the vortex of death. The Iron Kingdom most likely has a strong naval force at their disposal, due to living on islands, the numerous ships around their land, and those two anchors on their banner. But what's the purpose of this attack? If the supposed capital city of Dalmec fell, the Iron Kingdom would have a better chance of conquering the whole state, which just so happens to border on the Crystalline Dominion, which might be their main target. A direct attack is not possible due to this huge vortex blocking all naval traffic to the Crystalline Dominion by sea. Sailing all around either of the two continents is not an alternative either. It's possible that the Ironbloods started hunting down the Dominants, as their crystal orthodoxy might regard them as part of, or the reason for, the Blight. Taking over the Crystalline Dominion would give them a huge advantage in their quest, as would taking over the capital of Dalmec along the way. Some fans probably don't want to hear it anymore, but we do need to point out the uncompromised violence and its explicit depiction in this game. After Final Fantasy Versus 13 and Final Fantasy Type-0, 16 is the first mainline game to depict violence this way. It does add to the realism of the setting and time period, and sets the mood and atmosphere, as well as the stakes. Let's go through some relevant scenes for visualization. An Ironblood throws an axe into a Dalmec's shoulder and pulls it out afterwards. A Sanbrekian slices up an Ironblood's head from above a chocobo, and we see a cut-up Dalmec lying on the ground at the end of this clip. Clive slices and stabs the goblin with multiple strikes. Adult Clive slashing the Coerl before getting electrocuted. Clive uses dragon's claw attacks to scratch the ogre. Joshua's guardian's beheading splattering a huge load of blood into Joshua's face. A lot of blood can be seen on those murdered chocobos. Another axe kill by an Ironblood, during the last few frames when young Clive stabs the Marlborough. Towards the end, Ifrit is ripping into something, probably the Phoenix. Alright, enough strife and violence. Let's return to the beautiful world map and have a look at some more details. Befitting the medieval era, the world map bears some resemblance to a nautical map from the old days, both in terms of color scheme, design, and especially those compass roses, of which there are 8. It's probably just coincidence, but there are also apparently 8 icons, if you discount Ifrit, which apparently represents the mysterious 9th icon, as Clive's deleted bio suggests. More on that in the video about icons and their dominance. Back to the world map. It looks generally rather bland, as there's not much to see besides hills and mountain ranges, rivers, mother crystals, and locations to visit. Though, it's interesting that it shows ship icons, which probably indicate sailing and trading routes, or general ship occurrences. Unfortunately, the map doesn't show the actual routes. Still, this observation suggests that we might be able to travel by ship in some capacity. We hope for world map traversal in general. Not like the good old days, but more like a blend between open world and big zones, which show more landscape beyond the traversable area just to provide the illusion of vastness without the necessity for the developers to make every square inch traversable and risk empty segments and boring padding. 15. Excuse me. Although it's possible that this game offers an actual open world playground with sensible fast travel possibilities using this very map, and still manage to fill all of it with meaningful content. As far as ship travel goes, we might obtain our own at some point and are able to freely roam the seas. On the other hand, it might work the same as Final Fantasy XII, where airships act as a fast travel mechanic first and foremost. However, the player is able to roam the ship during travel, at least those for public transport. There, it's possible to talk to NPCs, buy items, and more. Fast travel ends after the player decides to enter their quarters for a nap. It's still unclear whether Velisthea, its two continents, and their surrounding islands cover the whole planet, which could mean that roaming freely around the sea would allow us to discover more continents or islands beyond what's shown here. It's also possible that they place invisible borders around this area, which tell us that we cannot sail any further due to treacherous waters or something. Final Fantasy XV also limited the permissible area for the Regalia Type F, and in Horizon Zero Dawn, we were also not allowed to cross certain thresholds close to the map's borders. It's also possible that those two continents encompass the entirety of this world, and we are able to sail all around the globe, like in every Final Fantasy entry before 10. We already somewhat touched on the darker areas before, so let's move it into focus now. It's notable that some darker areas cover realms or states completely, while other parts end randomly within a bordered area. This looks like a traditional fog of war, where unexplored terrain is covered by a darker color, or in the case of strategy games, a literal fog. It usually obstructs either just the points of interest, like in this case, or the whole area, so you don't see anything beyond the explored terrain. Viz first thought about those dark regions representing the Blight. However, this makes little sense, as it's too random and precise at the same time. The precise areas represent whole realms or states, while the random ones depict land still to be uncovered. Since we most likely start the game in Rosaria, it's only logical that the entirety of Rosaria, with its five provinces, is already explored. This state of the world map looks to be around halfway through the game, if we had to take a guess. We've already also explored most of Sandbreque, barring an area to the north still within its borders. Two out of the five states forming the Dalmekian Republic have also been uncovered by the player through traveling, barring a tiny segment right next to the border of the Crystalline Dominion. It's very much likely that story progression, visiting vantage points, or certain NPC information completely uncovers an area within certain borders, while the rest has to be uncovered by travel. Most of the Kingdom of Walode has also been explored already, but not everything. And herein lies the strongest evidence of the Fog of War, if you were still on the fence about it until now. Starting from the borders to the Crystalline Dominion, the uncovered area looks exactly like a path a player would take to go from there to the smaller town standing on the border to a small Sandbreckian territory on the eastern continent. As if the previous journey to the Kingdom of Walode encompassed only the northern half, with passage to the south blocked off by terrain, soldiers, or other means, which would explain the unexplored patch of land in the middle. Furthermore, the uncovered area doesn't just end at the border between Walodian and Sandbreckian soil, right above the town icon, but actually overlaps it. We also already explored the smaller northern islands of the Iron Kingdom, but not the bigger southern islands. Two Dalmekian states, the tiny island below, the small corner near the Drake's Head, possibly belonging to Walode, the northern territories, as well as the bigger part of the eastern continent, have yet to be explored. Lastly, we can spot a blurry island to the far southeast, also unexplored, but apparently accessible by ship. We presume that this one harbors an optional area, dungeon, or possibly even a super boss. Going off of the Fog of War hypothesis, icons visible on the world map then only represent known or already visited locations. Many more will likely appear when we uncover more territory, either by traveling there or by gathering information in general. It's also possible that there are even more Mother Crystals, like the Drake's right wing in the Northern Territories and the Drake's left wing in the southeastern realm of the Eastern Continent. On the other hand, a Drake has no wings. Only dragons and wyverns do, while the latter have wings as their forelegs. It's still possible that those who name the crystals don't care about accuracy. Final Fantasy VII Remake also got the naming completely wrong, as the Lesser Drake, the Cerulean Drake, and even the Rust Drake all should have been classified as wyverns instead of drakes. In terms of icons, there are several town icons which look exactly the same, and thus can be classified as less relevant locations while still being able to visit them. We see three in Rosaria, one in Dalmec, one in Sandbreck, and one in Willowed on the border of Sandbreck. There's also this fort icon, which is shown twice. One in Rosaria and one in Sandbreckian territory, which sits atop some hills. Other icons also exist, for example, a waterfall. So specific dungeon locations are also a thing. We don't see many of them yet, as others may most likely still need to be discovered. However, uncovering landmasses automatically doesn't seem to also uncover all points of interest within. Otherwise, we'd see many more icons in Willowed and Dalmec. Other dungeon icons encompass mountains and strangely shaped spikes, both on Sandbreckian ground. The latter looks like a mix between a Jedi temple and the skull of a swordfish or bird poking out of the ground. It's possible that this represents some sort of ancient ruin, and somewhat resembles those strange white stone fragments scattered about in this forest area where adult Clive fights an ogre. There's even a river nearby, which can also be seen on the world map. Lastly, we see this strange vortex very close to the Crystalline Dominion. We already talked about it a bit before on how it might play into certain conflicts. But what caused it in the first place? Could it be a result of the terrain modification caused by the falling crystal landing right between those two continents? Now, with all that being said, this game looks more and more interesting the deeper we dive into its world. The supposed in-game world map looks fantastic, and the six revealed realms and their history, connections, and conflicts feel already very much fleshed out, as well as the lore of the world as a whole. While Viz felt apprehensive about this project at first, he's now completely enamored with its intricacies, and we all can't wait for more information. And with that short personal opinion, also ends the first analysis video about Final Fantasy XVI. We hope we could win you over as well if you happen to still be on the fence about this interesting project. The upcoming episodes of Game Analysis will alternate between more Final Fantasy XVI content, covering the icons, dominance, characters, story predictions, and the battles, and the remaining mysteries lingering within Final Fantasy VII Remake, such as Cloud's memory glitches, Sephiroth, and the ending. For even more content, updates, and discussions, follow us on Twitter, and join our lovely Discord server! And if you'd like to support us even further, feel free to drop a pledge on our Patreon or Subscribestar page. You can find all the links in the description below. If you enjoyed this first step into the world of Valisthea, give us a like, subscribe, hit the bell icon, and select all notifications to not miss out on any upcoming analysis videos. With that being said, thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope to see you again in the next analysis. Stay safe and take care. Kudakuma signing off.